Recorded Books presents an unabridged recording of Murder in Montmartre by Cara Black, narrated by Carine Montbertrand. The author opens with a quote from Françoise Sagan. In Paris, the past is ever present. One can never escape it. And now, Murder in Montmartre.
Paris, 1995, January, a Monday night. Emile Leduc's heels sank into the snow-crusted surface of the Paris street, quiet and deserted except for the whisper of ghosts. There were always ghosts, she thought, and they were even more poignant at this time of year, souls wandering at night over the cobblestones, flitting through the dark paved courtyards, leaving exhalations of the past behind them. The metallic edge to the winter air promised a storm. Below her, ice-veiled barges, surrounded by escaping steam, swayed on the surface of the slow-moving Seine. Quayside lights pricked the black water like so many stars. The hushed night noises, absorbed by the new-fallen snow, seemed planets away. She hurried along the Ile Saint-Louis quay to her building, a relic of the 17th century, and mounted the steps, worn into grooves with the passage of time. Inside her cold apartment, she met stale air and darkness. Disappointed, she hung her bag on the hook by the door. It was the third time this week Guy had been out at night, on call. She heard a click, just audible. Alarmed, she switched on the light and called out, "Guy, is that you?" He stood in the doorway, facing her, his white evening shirt collar unbuttoned, hands in his tuxedo jacket pockets, the expression in his gray eyes unreadable. She gasped. Caught up in work, she'd forgotten the reception he was hosting as department head for Doctors Without Borders. "Guy, forgive me, but..."
"I was late for the reception," he interrupted. "When I reached the hospital, there was an emergency waiting for me. I was 4 minutes away from my patient's losing his sight tonight. If I'd been there on time..." "But I waited for you."
A hot flush spread over her cheeks. "Work! I'm sorry. You should have gone ahead without me. I didn't think..."
"You know, at medical school, they taught us to identify, isolate, and incise a malignancy," he said.
Her muscles tightened. A cold chill emanated from him.
"And to remove it before it spreads, engulfing the organs, choking the lymph systems."
"Guy, look, it goes both ways."
He headed to the bedroom, pausing in the doorway to say, "Which crisis this time, Emmy? The computer crashed, you were chasing an account that hasn't paid, you were lost on a hacking trail, or René left early and you had to cope?"
"Not bad. 3 out of 4, Guy."
She wanted to feel the warmth of his surgeon's hands on her skin, his wonderful hands, his tapered fingers that had stroked her spine under the silk duvet last night. A lost look crossed his face. Then it was gone. "It's not working, Emmy." He opened the armoire and threw shirts into a duffel bag. He was serious.
"You'd flunk out of the Navy," she said, blocking his path.
He stared at her. "What?"
"You jump ship at the first sign of rough water."
"We've had this argument before." He shook his head, looking down. "I wanted us to work."
"But it's not just me," she interrupted. "You're always on call. You go away for 3 weeks at a time to medical conferences."
She left out the holidays and Saint-Sylvestre, New Year's Eve.
"I know." He looked away. Stupid. Why had she said it? Never rely on a man or let them know that you do. "Guy, I'll tattoo your schedule on my brain."
She reached out and pulled him to her, enveloping herself in his arms.
Nothing ever felt like this before.
He traced his warm finger along her cheekbone. She closed her eyes, inhaling his lime vetiver scent. She felt something land in her pocket with a metallic sound.
"Here are your keys,"
Guy said. "Let's work this out," she said, fighting her fear. Why had she ignored the warning signs?
"It's better this way, Emmy, for you and for me. I'm sorry."
He grabbed the duffel bag, strode through the hall. "But Guy!" He was out the door before she could stop him. Crushed, she ran to the window and pressed her nose against the cold glass as she watched him get into a taxi on the quay below. She heard the door slam and the taxi's tires churn away over the slush. Her eyes welled with tears. 2 months of living together, trying to. He was the man who'd saved her eyesight, who'd written poetry about her. Now he was gone, just like that. Relationships. She didn't get them. Shouldn't people take each other as they found them? She'd blown it. Again. She sank onto the duvet, stunned, and grabbed the pillow. She found herself clutching one of his socks. She remembered lying in bed at sunrise as the blood-orange sun peeked above their toes outside the window, how his long fingers brushed her thigh, the bowl of steaming café au lait he'd prepared, resting next to the thick Le Monde diplomatique on the balcony, awaiting Sunday morning reading. She remembered how his nose wrinkled when he laughed. She buried her face in the pillow, punched it, trying to shut out the hollow ache inside her. A small wet tongue licked her ear. Miles Davis, her bichon frisé, panted eagerly, carrying his leash. She heard his low whine. "Just you and me now, Miles," she said. A jade bangle, green and luminous, hung by the beveled mirror on the birch branch where she kept her jewelry. It caught the gleam from the barge lights. It had been given to her by an old Vietnamese woman for good luck. She felt its cold smoothness as she slipped it onto her wrist, then pulled on a black down jacket, looped 2 wool scarves around her neck, and descended the drafty stairs, her heart leaden, to walk her dog. A January night, and she felt as if she and Miles Davis were the only ones in Paris, except for the ghosts. She'd lost her man. A barge floated by with red Christmas lights still strung along the sides, framing the flat deck. A scratchy strain of a song accompanied by an accordion reached her, and she heard the lapping of wavelets. Miles Davis wandered along, sniffing around the metal grill that surrounded the base of a leafless tree. She rubbed the jade, but no reassuring warmth answered. Her cell phone vibrated in her coat pocket. "Guy?" "Allô?" she said, hope in her voice. "Bibiche!" She recognized Laure Rousseau's voice. Laure was the daughter of her father's first partner, and the endearment was the one she'd used since they were 8 years old. "Come celebrate. Ouvrier's retiring. Remember him?" Ouvrier was a horse-faced fleek from her father's old commissariat. She heard conversation and the pinging of a pinball machine in the background. A bar? Not her scene, with a bunch of old fleeks reminiscing and drinking, the type who'd joined the force before the Earth's crust had cooled. "I've got good news, Bibiche. Don't I owe you a drink? Sounds like you've already started." "The seat next to me is warm," Laure said. Emmy thought of her empty apartment filled with cold, stale air. "Place Pigalle, you remember l'oiseau?" Singing erupted in the background. She'd prefer falling off a stool with Laure to drinking by herself at the corner bistro. Emmy looked down. The snow crystals crunched below her feet. Miles Davis had finished. She could take him upstairs. "I'll grab a taxi. See you in 15 minutes. This slice of Montmartre had witnessed several heydays,
Before the turn of the century, Edgar Degas had discovered his models here among the grisettes, young women waiting for work amid the horse-drawn milk carts. Now the sex clubs and cut-rate North African shops contributed a different flavor. Still, pockets of cobbled lanes with two-story artists' ateliers dotted the route winding up to Sacré-Cœur, which crowned the steep hill. Aimé entered Loiseau through a haze of cigarette smoke and close, steamy air. The party was in full swing. Thank God she'd stuck on a second Nicorette patch in the taxi. Plainclothes fleeks in their 60s and older propped up the zinc bar and sat at the small round tables. She recognized several faces, men who'd worked with her father. They were more at home at a zinc bar than in their own kitchens. In this group, where she'd once belonged, she now felt like an outsider. Her godfather, Morbier, a commissaire, sat at the counter, his tweed elbow-patched jacket smelling of wet wool. She brightened, seeing a gold paper crown tilted on his salt-and-pepper hair, incongruous with his basset hound drooping eyes and sagging cheeks. A half-eaten slice of galette du roi, epiphany cake, and a small ceramic centon charm sat in front of him. Where was Guy? Forget it. She needed a drink. Now you're the king, eh, Morbier? Where's Laure? She asked, motioning to the owner and helping herself to an almond paste-filled tart. She took a sip from Morbier's glass, then another. The same, please, Jean. She felt a tap on her shoulder and turned. Laure Rousseau, grinning, stood framed against a yellowed Marseille soccer team poster that was peeling from the tobacco-stained walls. As always, her hand flicked across her mouth, a small, self-conscious movement she made to hide the thin white line crossing her upper lip, the remnant of a cleft palate, long since corrected by surgery.
"So, Bibiche," Laure said, her brown eyes scanning Aimé. "You want to talk about the truck that ran you down?"
"That obvious." Aimé choked and spilled her glass. Burgundy splattered on the zinc counter. Laure reached for a rag and wiped up the mess.
"That bad?"
Laure asked again. She nodded. "Guy's on call. Permanently on call."
"Ah, the eye doctor. You've broken up?"
Laure asked.
"I'm sorry."
Aimée tapped her foot on the cracked brown tiled floor, littered with sugar cube wrappers and cigarette butts. "I blew it. But rather than go into it, maybe I should leave. I don't want to spoil the evening."
Laure put her arm around Aimée's shoulder. "Let's get rid of that long face. Tell me."
And Aimée did.
"He'll be back," Laure said.
"I'm not holding my breath. We're too different." Aimée picked up a new glass and threw back a shot. Men came and went, didn't they? There was always another one. With more wine, she'd convince herself of that and maybe get through the night.
"Bibiche," Laure hugged her. "You can have anyone in here any time. The trouble is they're all divorced, can't keep a relationship going for a minute, and are as old as your papa and mine."
"As old as my father would have been," Aimée said. "It's been 5 years, Laure." The Place Vendôme explosion that had killed her father was now just a lost file in the ministry, the one lead she'd had from Interpol, cold by now. She tried to shove these thoughts aside, too. How familiar this smoky café bar was, the kind where she and Laure had sat playing endless tic-tac-toe games while their fathers worked weekend stakeouts. She noticed the furrow in Laure's brow and that her friend kept tossing back her long straight brown hair nervously. The navy blue pantsuit hung on her. "You've lost weight," Aimée said. Laure averted her close-set brown eyes.
"I can't keep these dinosaurs in line," Laure said a beat later. At least the old school types don't toss out sexual innuendos every 5 minutes and tease me like the new recruits at the commissariat do. My life's on the line every day, just like theirs. When I leave in the morning, I don't know if I'll come back. Still, they think I'm fair game.
You're on patrol, just what you wanted, Aimée said, noticing the pin on Laure's lapel.
I'd offer congratulations, but you know how I feel about your patrolling.
Laure had left paperwork behind and was now assigned to active duty. Patrolling wasn't a job Aimée thought wise for her. They'd had endless discussions over it. Laure's need to prove herself, whether it arose from her complex over the hair lip that had marred her appearance until the operation, or from her desire to match her father's decorated service, hadn't changed. Why must you put your life on the line? Again, that averted gaze, the hand motion brushing over her mouth. Raucous laughter erupted from a knot of back-slapping gray-haired men, drowning Laure's reply. The well-lubricated crowd, conversing at a roar, competed with the pinging of the 1950s pinball machine.
Encore?
Jean, the owner, asked, pointing to her glass. Laure shook her head. Something bothering you, Laure?
Laure jerked a thumb toward a man in his 30s with black, slicked-back hair and a clipped mustache, who was crouched over the zinc counter.
My partner, Jacques Gagnère.
Aimée noticed Jacques's mouth twitch as he spoke into a cell phone while lighting a gitane cigarette. His hands shook so much it took him 2 tries to light his cigarette. Aimée had seen a lot of nervous fleeks in bars like this. The ex-military type who'd joined the police approaching middle age. Just divorced?
Bien sûr, got a new green Citroën and a girlfriend. The usual, Laure confirmed.
It must be nerve-wracking to have a partner like that, Aimée thought. She took another sip, aware of the whispering and the pointed looks at Laure. Was there more to it?
What's the buzz? You're up for promotion already?
Laure took a deep breath and shook her head. Then she excused herself and joined Jacques. Aimée downed her glassful and had ordered another when she heard Laure's voice over the din.
The last time!
She saw Laure's flushed face. She was pounding her fist on the counter. The hush that fell over the bar was punctuated by the pinging of the pinball machine. Aimée reached Laure's side just as Laure grabbed Jacques' drink. She seized Laure's hand before she could throw it.
Tiens, Laure, what's the matter?
Jacques' lips, which had been set in a thin line, formed a grin.
Having a partner is like being married, you know?
He nudged Ouvrier sitting next to him, wearing a Sunday best pinstripe suit that Aimée knew he'd trotted out for the occasion. She'd only ever seen him in uniform until now.
Almost, Ouvrier?
Ouvrier's nervous laughter answered him. Others quickly joined in, and amidst the tinkle of glasses, conversations resumed.
Time to go.
Jacques stood up, placed a 10-franc note between the wet rings on the zinc bar, and shot Laure a look.
You coming or not?
She's having a conversation with me, Aimée said, her voice rising as she stepped closer to Jacques. Aren't you off duty?
Since when is it your business?
He asked. Before Aimée could answer, Laure tugged at her sleeve.
I'll be back in 5 minutes, she said in Aimée's ear. I'm just going 2 blocks away.
Laure had a certain look in her eyes, the same look she'd had once when she'd given her report card to Aimée to hide. The cafe owner waved away any payment and wiped the counter with a none-too-clean towel.
On the house, he said.
2 blocks away? Jacques's a big boy. Can't he handle it himself? Aimée asked. But Laure was already grabbing her coat from the rack. With her gloved hand, she flashed 5 fingers at Aimée and followed Jacques through the door. Aimée watched them from the window as they talked. The next time she looked, they'd crossed the street. Monday night.
The red light flickered on Jacques' grinning face, giving him a devilish look. He stood by the dirty snowdrift, buttoning his jacket.
"It's not funny, Jacques," Laure said.
He shrugged, and his expression changed to one he bestowed on puppies, or assumed when he'd surrendered a seat to an old lady on the bus.
"A shame to make such a scene, Laure."
"You know why."
"Sweet, you're sweet, Laure. Quit worrying about my prescriptions. The clinic prescribes these pills to keep my back from tensing up."
His nervous twitches had grown more pronounced, and the cocktail of pills he'd just swallowed with his drink hadn't stopped them.
"Look, Jacques, it's my career too, and this is my first patrol assignment." "Who helped you, huh? Who talked the commissaire into overlooking your test results?"
She'd had low scores. It was true. She ignored the flashing neon sexodrome sign that was casting red flashes onto his face, as well as the large photos of semi-clad women advertising the fading allure of Pigalle. He flicked his cigarette into the gutter. Its orange tip sputtered and died in the gray slush.
"I wanted you along, partner," he said, "in case."
"In case?" Surprise and a quick ripple of pride coursed through her. Yet nothing was simple with Jacques.
"Why do I feel you're going to do something stupid?" "But I won't if you're with me. I'm meeting an informer. I'll play it right."
Like he'd played it right into divorce and pills? The falling snow that had carpeted the street turned to slush under the buses, but frosted the Le Sex Live 24/7 billboard above them like confectioner's sugar. As he'd just reminded her, not only had Jacques recommended her, he'd taken her as a partner when no one else volunteered. He'd invited her for drinks after work and made her talk about her day, gotten her to laugh and bolstered her confidence. She owed Jacques.
"Who's this informer, and why is meeting him tonight so important?" Laure asked.
"No questions. Trust me." The new Citroën he made payments on and the hip flask he sipped from when he thought she wasn't looking bothered her. Jacques had a stellar record, but his divorce had hit him hard.
"I know you're under pressure," she said. "You worry me. Before we go to the meet, let's talk it over."
Jacques beamed a smile at her.
"I haven't asked you for anything, Laure. I need this." "Like you need..."
"It's personal," Jacques said.
The rising wind gusted snow over their feet.
"This informer's complicated."
"Doesn't Vice handle informers these days?" Laure asked.
"Building trust and gaining an informer's confidence takes time. Little by little, laying the groundwork. I'm teaching you, remember? You with me, partner?"
Her reluctance wavered. Jacques winked.
"Like I said, 5 minutes and then we'll go back to Loiseau, okay?"
She ignored her misgivings as she pulled a wool cap over her thick brown hair, determined to discover what had made Jacques' upper lip glisten with perspiration, what had made him twitch. Place Pigalle, deserted by pedestrians, lay behind them. Only the sex club barkers who rubbed their arms while greeting the taxis pulling up in front of their doorways were still out. Jacques gestured to his parked Citroën.
"I thought we were only going 2 blocks, she said.
"That's right," he said, "but we'll get there and back faster in this weather if we drive."
They passed the corner guitar store, a heavy metal hangout in the daytime, in a quartier thick with instrument shops. Turning into Rue André-Antoine, they rode by a small hotel. Fresh snow layered the mansard roofs of the white stone Haussmann-style buildings. A black-coated woman, teetering in heels and fishnet stockings, stood under a lampadaire in a doorway at the corner, then stepped back into the shadow. Jacques parked at the curb, where the street curved, He pushed a button on a grillwork gate, and it buzzed, and the gate clicked open.
Laure caught up with him as he strode across the small courtyard, her feet crunching on the ice. The building's upper floors and roof were wrapped in wooden scaffolding. She stamped the snow from her feet, wishing she'd worn wool socks and different boots. Her gloves, she'd forgotten them in the car. Jacques hit the digicode and a door opened to a tattered red-carpeted hall.
"Wait here," Jacques said.
"In a freezing vestibule?"
He was going to do something stupid. Police procedure required that a pair keep together, not split up.
"We're a team, aren't we?"
"Team?" On the job, they were.
"We're off duty, remember?" she said. "How personal is this?"
"More than you know. But you can quit worrying. I know what I'm doing."
He tugged his earlobe, a mannerism some women might find endearing. Grinned.
"Monsieur Charme" was what they'd nicknamed him at the commissariat. "Tell me what's going on, Jacques."
"I just need some backup."
Was she reading this wrong?
"So you want me to warn you in case some thug shows up?"
He put his fingers to his lips and winked.
"Trust you to figure it out."
Jacques ran up the stairs. She listened as his footsteps stopped on the third landing.
Laure studied the names on the mailboxes uneasily. It didn't add up. A cold 5 minutes later, she followed the red carpet up the creaking staircase. Three flights up, in a dim hallway filled with piles of wood and an old sink, cold drafts swirled against her face. An open door led into a dark apartment.
"Jacques, quit playing games," she called out.
No answer. What had the fool done now? She stepped into the apartment, into musty darkness, her footsteps echoing on the wood floor. It seemed vacant. From an open window, gusts of snow blew onto the floor. And then she heard a distant sound of breaking glass. Alarmed, she unzipped her jacket and drew the gun she'd only fired previously on the shooting range. Her heart raced. Drugs. Was he on the take? No way in hell would she risk her badge for his dope habit. She peered out the window. No Jacques. She climbed out onto the scaffold and navigated the slippery two-plank walkway, gripping the stone building, her bare hands frigid.
"Laure!"
Jacques' voice. The rest of his words were lost in the wind. A howling gust whipped across her face as she pulled herself up from the scaffolding and reached for the gray-blue tile edge of the slippery roof. A punch knocked her to her knees. The second blow cracked her head against the scaffold with a bright flash of light. Monday night. Amy peered again at her Tintin watch. Nearly 11 o'clock. What's taking Laure so long? Morbier shrugged, taking a swig from his wine glass.
Better congratulate Ouvrier now before he leaves.
Ouvrier stood near them, holding an open blue velvet box containing a glinting gold watch.
35 years of service.
She saw a wistful look on his long face. Congratulations, Ouvrier. Aimé nudged him. How will you keep out of trouble now?
Ma petite, I've had enough trouble, he said, giving her a little smile.
Ouvrier, widowed and estranged from his children, subject to flare-ups in winter from a knee injury in his rookie days, had been sidelined. A new generation of fleeks was taking over. She felt for him, aware of his scars, inside and out. For now, he had camaraderie, but not much else to show for years of service besides the gold watch. Where was Laure? Amy stood and pulled on her coat. There was only one way to find out. She crossed Place Pigalle toward the mounting zinc rooftops silhouetted against the moon-like dome of Sacré-Cœur. Midway, In a frame shop, the white-coated, long-haired owner nodded to her as he pulled the blinds down, but not before she saw the notice of an upcoming organic market below a Warhol-style silkscreen print of Che Guevara, black and red all over. Montmartre embodied the bohemian spirit. In its past, it had been the home of anarchist communards, and then of artists and writers for whom absinthe provided inspiration. Now it held a mix of small cafes and theaters that hosted poetry readings, or a playwright testing a first act on patrons, and dance studios occupying ateliers that once boasted students like Van Gogh. Young Parisians treasured converted studios here, trading the trudge up the steep streets and flights of stairs for the view of the sweeping panorama below, just as Utrillo, Renoir, and Picasso once made their homes in cheap ateliers. This was where the Impressionists, Cubists, and Surrealists had painted. The tradition of the village, eccentric and stubborn, still remained. There was no sign of Laure. Aimée turned the corner and saw a new Citroën at the curb under a no-parking tow-zone sign. Only a flic would dare. It was a nice chrome-green Citroën, too. Jacques? A glance through the half-frosted window revealed a crushed pill bottle on the floor by the clutch and blue gloves on the passenger seat. Laure's gloves. Something smelled bad, as her father would have said. A gate stood open. Fresh footsteps in the snow trailed across to a darkened building. She entered and crossed the courtyard, her heels slipping on the ice. Strains of music from the building opposite wafted through the courtyard, and patches of light came from a window. Another party? Snow clumped in the building's half-open door. Aimée walked inside into the dark foyer. A broken stained glass window and water-stained doors met her gaze. There was a darkened concierge's loge on the right. Once plush and exclusive, she thought, now the building looked shabby. Laure? A gust of wind rattled the metal mailboxes. Wet footprints mounted the red-carpeted stairs. She followed them to the third floor. Piles of lumber and paint cans sat under a skylight attesting to a renovation in progress. The apartment door stood open. Allô? No answer. She went inside, her footsteps echoing in a hallway. Beyond lay a dark, nearly empty series of rooms swallowed by shadows. What looked like a piano stood ghost-like, covered by a sheet. She shivered and backed up. In this bitter cold, half-empty apartment, something felt very wrong. Metal clanged from outside where a construction scaffold was visible through the open salon window. Had Jacques and Laure, the idiots, gone out there? Snow blew in through the window, dusting a large armchair and wetting the carpet as it melted. She stepped over the window ledge to the scaffold, which was barely illuminated by the dim light of the moon. Freezing wind and gusting snow flurries met her. Gloves. She needed gloves and a snowsuit. At the shadowy scaffold's end, she could just make out a slanted mansard rooftop, and behind it, a small flat area piled with rebar and bricks. Snow crusted the wooden slats over the windows. Suffused moonlight showed a mesh of footprints. She heard creaking and forced herself to traverse the scaffold to look beyond the pepper pot chimneys and zinc rooftops laced with snow stretching like steps down the hill of Montmartre. Taking small steps, Aimée edged toward the roof edge and tripped. Her arms flew out. Icy slush brushed her cheeks. Then she saw Laure's sprawled body. Laure! She cried. A groan answered. Laure! Can you hear me? She said, bending down. Her fingers located a weak pulse on her friend's neck. She rooted in Laure's pockets for a police radio, couldn't find one, pulled out her cell phone, and tried to control her shaking hands to punch in 1-8, the emergency number for the police. "Officer down, possibly two, 18 rue André-Antoine, on the roof," she said. "Send backup, an ambulance. Hurry!" The commissariat was nearby. Would they get here in time?
"Jacques,"
Laure moaned. Dull thuds came from somewhere on the roof.
"Help him. Have to."
Emmy tried to control her panic. Think. She had to think straight. "Laure, backup's on the way. What's going on?"
"Jacques couldn't wait anymore. Some informer. He saved me. Oh, Jacques."
If he'd saved Laure's life, Emmy hesitated. "You came up here after Jacques? Where is he?"
"Over there. Take my gun. Help him."
The last thing she wanted to do was deal with Jacques or his informer. Sleet gusted and the rising wind took her breath away. Emmy felt for Laure's holster. It was empty. Worried, she stood, took a few steps and climbed onto the tiled rooftop, grabbing at the chimney to steady herself. She worked her way across the slick roof, the sleet blinding her. And then her legs buckled. She landed on something bulky, inert, a body. Her gaze locked on its staring eyes. Jacques' eyes, his eyelashes flecked with snowflakes. Terror coursed through her as sirens wailed in the distance. She brushed the snow from her face, and her hands came back covered with pink-red slush. Blood! "Jacques!" He blinked, the whites of his eyes showing. He was trying to tell her something. She checked his neck and found a weak pulse, the carotid artery. She pulled herself to her knees, pinched his nose shut, checked his tongue, and started blowing air into his mouth. Her hands were so cold. None of the breath and pause sequences elicited a response from his blue lips. "Can you hear me, Jacques? Can you talk?" His mouth moved. She folded her hands, began quick, sharp thrusts to his chest. As Jacques tried to speak, a thin line of blood trailed from his mouth. She thrust harder now, counting and breathing. The air was stinging cold. Faster now, because while she panted and thrust, she felt him go limp. "Don't leave me now, Jacques!" She didn't know how long her frozen, numb hands worked on Jacques. Finally, she heard footsteps on the scaffolding and the clang of metal. Chalk-white beams blinded her. "Take over! Respond!" She struggled, trying to get her breath. She heard static from a police radio and the words, "Move away from the gun!" And then she was flying into the wall, tackled, her head shoved into the snow. She couldn't breathe. Her hands were wrenched behind her. She heard the clink and felt the cold steel of handcuffs. She fought, jerking her head, tried to move her legs. "What are you doing?" She spit out the ice that had been forced into her mouth. More radio static, biting wind. Catching her breath, she shouted, "Help him, for God's sake!" A medic leaned over Jacques. She heard the words,
"Crackling, subcutaneous emphysema, wound seepage."
A stark white beam of light showed the black-red bullet hole and the blood seeping from Jacques' chest.
"Too late," the medic said. "He's gone."
Her shoulders slumped.
"Backup's here. Crime scene units on the way,"
a hoarse voice shouted. When it was one of their own, they made it a priority response.
"Move her. Careful."
She felt her arms lifted, hips shoved forward.
"I've seen it before," the hoarse voice said. "They shoot them, then try to save."
"What do you mean? Check the roof," Emmy said, melting ice running down her face. "Someone attacked the officer on the scaffold. I heard noises and came up here and found her, then him."
"So, you shot him? With his own gun?"
"You're wrong. I tried to save him." More footsteps and a portable halogen light illuminated Jacques' body, slumped on the slanted rooftop between the chimney pots.
His coat and pants pockets had been turned inside out. Clumped red matter spread across the snow. He'd been shot at close range, Amy observed, horrified. In the beam of the halogen light, Amy saw a Manurin F138-357 Magnum non-automatic, the standard police handgun, in a plastic bag laid down on the blue tarp. Jacques' gun or Laure's? Snowy sleet whipped by, sending flurries across the roof. An officer, his crew cut sprinkled with snow, rolled up Jacques' pants.
His gun's still strapped to his ankle, yet this Manurin's police issue.
It must belong to the officer at the edge of the roof, Aimé said.
And it just flew over here?
He asked. She realized she'd better shut up and wait to explain to the investigating magistrate. He leaned into his matchbox-sized monitor and spoke.
Bag the hands of the officer below and check for gunshot residue.
You've got it all wrong, Aimé burst out, despite her resolve. Jacques came up here alone to meet someone. She'd deduced that from what Laure had said.
And bag this woman's, too, he said. We'll send her down.
The wind rose again, whipping more snow into lacy flurries. Each breath stung. She wanted to wind her scarf over her mouth. The level 3 weather warning had turned into a first-class storm. The plastic sheeting the crime scene unit had raised whipped into shreds in the wind and blew away.
"Get another plastic sheet, quick!" a crime scene technician shouted. "Now! Haven't seen a storm like this since 1969!"
A few members of the crime scene unit unpacked their equipment on the coating of ice by the skylight, making a futile attempt to deal with the area.
"The light's changing every second," said the photographer, pulling out his camera, his shoes crunching on the brittle snow. "Hurry up, I can't get a good light meter reading."
Aimé noted the interlacing footprints. Any evidence there might have been was now compromised.
"Take her downstairs," the officer said, an edge to his voice.
"I know my rights."
The officer waved her away. From the edge of the roof, Aimé saw flakes swirling in flashlight beams and snow-carpeted rooftops stretching toward distant Gare du Nord. Across the courtyard, several lit windows appeared amid the yawning dark ones. Strains of bossa nova fluttered on the wind. That party in the adjoining building was still going on. Down in the apartment, Laure crouched as a group of men with snow-dusted shoulders huddled about her, an anguished look on her pale face as the gloved technicians pressed double-sided adhesive tape over her fingers and palms. The wind blowing from the window snatched away their conversation, but she overheard custody at the commissariat.
"Bibiche!"
Aimé froze. Laure's hair was matted and wet. A large knot welled on her temple. The white of one eye was discolored with blood.
"Poor Jacques! Who'll tell his ex-wife?"
she asked as she tried to stand and slipped on the wet floor. An officer steadied her.
"Sorry, Laure. You know I have to do this and report anything you say," he said.
"Report what she says," Aimé repeated, raising her voice to be heard over the wind.
"Laure needs medical attention."
The flic turned to Aimé, irritated.
"Who gave you permission to talk, mademoiselle?"
"I'm a private detective."
"Then you should know better," he said, nodding his head at the man beside him. "Run this woman's ID. Why hasn't someone bagged her hands for gunshot residue?"
Edith Mézard, La Proc, the investigating magistrate, entered wearing a black cocktail dress under a fur stole. She stamped the snow from her heels. Procedure dictated that in dicey situations she arrive at the same time as the brigade criminelle.
"Désolée, Madame La Proc," the flic said.
Aimé stepped forward. Recognition dawned in Edith Mézard's eyes.
"Mademoiselle Leduc," she sniffed, then frowned.
Light a match to your breath and the building would go up in flames.
Before Aimée could respond, La Proque cleared her throat.
Give me the details, Inspector. How does it come about that a fleek shoots another fleek on a slippery zinc-tiled roof in a snowstorm? Convince me.
We found her weapon on the roof.
Was it next to her?
The officer in question lay on the scaffolding below, he said, abashed. Her gun lay next to Jacques, the victim.
Merde, La Proque said under her breath, pulling out tennis shoes from her Vuitton bag.
What? Are you accusing Laure of shooting her partner? Aimée said. That's absurd.
Or maybe you shot him, mademoiselle, said the inspector.
Panic coursed through her.
Take her statement at the commissariat, Edith Mézard said, before climbing out the window.
The fleek shoved Aimée forward and down the stairs. The few bystanders in the narrow street, an old woman, her bathrobe flapping under her overcoat, a man with tired eyes in a blue-green bus driver's uniform, were illuminated by the blue rays of the revolving SAMU ambulance light.
Morbier stood by an old parked Mercedes, its roof flattened under the weight of the snow. A tow truck driver had hitched Jacques' green Citroën to his truck.
They've got it all wrong, Morbier, Aimée called out.
Move along, mademoiselle, said the fleek,
pushing her toward the blue and white police van.
Just a moment, officer, Morbier said.
The officer raised his eyebrows, eyeing first Morbier and then Aimée's black leather pants, down jacket, and spiky hair. Morbier flashed his ID.
Give me a moment.
Bien sûr, commissaire, the fleek said,
taken aback.
What mess have you gotten yourself into this time, Leduc?
Morbier asked, his breath misting in the freezing air.
You got that right, Morbier. A terrible mess.
She gave him a brief account.
Morbier listened, pulling out a Monte Cristo cigarillo, cupping his hands and lighting it with a wooden match.
He puffed, sending acrid whiffs into Aimée's face, and tossed the match into the snow where it went thumped. When she finished, he shook his head and looked away silently. Why didn't he say anything?
Morbier, help me convince them.
Might as well teach rocks to swim, Leduc. There's procedure. You know that. Do the drill. You're a suspect. Shut your mouth.
Shut my mouth?
Until you give your statement, he said. Be smart.
She controlled her horror. Of course he was right. She'd explain, diagram her route, show that Laure couldn't have killed Jacques.
Laure wouldn't shoot her partner after practically the whole police force had seen them together in the café.
Morbier flicked his ashes. They caught in the wind.
And witness their fight and your meddling, he said.
She'd forgotten about that public scene.
You've got clout, Morbier, she said. Use it.
For once, she hoped he'd listen to her.
The fleek grabbed Aimée's elbow in an iron grip.
I'm sorry, commissaire, the van's waiting. What a night for this to happen.
Morbier expelled his breath with a noise she recognized for what it was. Resignation underlaid with the steel note of authority. A mode he'd perfected. Voices drifted from above them. Lights glowed from the building's roof.
Aimée noticed a black leather-coated man, a pack on his back, standing in a doorway. He watched them intently, listening, as if gauging the situation. Could he have witnessed the shooting? A battered Renault Twingo skidded to a halt beside the white morgue van. Several men jumped out, cameras in hand or on straps slung over their chests.
The press. Excuse us, commissaire. Allez-y, mademoiselle.
The fleek bundled Aimée away before she could point out the possible witness to Morbier. He shoved her into the police van, handcuffed her wrists to the bar behind her like a criminal. She slipped on the floor, which had been salted to slow a prisoner's traction if he aimed to bolt.
She felt each cobblestone as her spine jounced against the hard seat and the van headed, siren blaring, into the night. Monday night. At the bark of a gun above him, Lucien Sarti had jumped and ducked into a blackened stone doorway. A reflex. Knots clenched his stomach. He wanted to melt into the stone. He worried about crossfire. Relentless sleet pelted the buildings. Peering up the curving street, he saw no one else on the glistening, icy surface. Then clumps of snow fell from a scaffolding above and crumbled on the cobblestones. He saw a movement, heard thuds. Lucien moved back deeper into the doorway, pulled his black leather coat tighter, waited. He brushed the snow from his curling black hair. Given his history, the best thing would be to leave, run, get away. But his big chance lay a stone's throw off, just around the corner. His luck. The warren of 19th-century soot-stained buildings and twisted mounting streets reminded him of Rue du Castagneau in Bastia's old port. But instead of sun-baked stone, the sirocco whipping from Africa, and old women knitting on their steps, the steep stairs ahead held clusters of new snow, gusts of wind, and prostitutes who'd stepped into the shadows. He waited until he saw flickers of light and heard the wail like a cat in heat, and then sirens. As he was about to run across the street, the door behind him was opened by an old man leading a Westie on a leash. "Think fast," he told himself. "Pardon, I forgot the door code," he said to the old man. "My friends live on the second floor." The old man nodded, a muffler wrapped high around his neck, and Lucien edged his way inside. He waited on the dank building's pitted stone staircase until the thumps in his heart subsided, until he heard cars pulling up and voices outside. He figured it would be easier now to blend into a crowd and cross the courtyard. Since birth, he'd been taught to keep his mouth shut. Aqua in boca. His grand-mère would indicate the need for silence by sliding her finger across her lips. He knew better than to get involved. He threaded his way past the police van to the gate and paused, listening. Snatches of conversation drifted on the sleeting wind. Shooting on the rooftop was all he could understand. No way could he get involved. This city was filled with contradictions, unlike his native Corsica, where it was simple. All outsiders were viewed as a threat. Satisfied that no one had noticed him in the flurry of activity, Lucien made his way across the snowdrifts in the courtyard to a jewel-like townhouse. He opened the front door and mounted the staircase, passing several landings until an open door revealed a well-dressed crowd in the foyer. A party? He should have worn his new shirt. Conari had just told him to stop by for a brief meeting. As a woman leaned toward an arriving couple to greet them, a scent of roses wafted from her. Familiar. Snowflakes danced outside the foyer window, catching the light and framing her tan, smooth back. Only one woman he'd ever known would wear something like that in this weather. But it couldn't be. And then he lost her in the crowd of newcomers.
"Lucien, so glad you're here!"
A voice, loud and welcoming, came from his host, broad-shouldered Félix Conari, who filled the doorway. Long charcoal gray hair curled behind his ears. His skin was Côte d'Azur bronzed, the all-year bronze of the wealthy.
"Do come in. It's wonderful you made it."
"Bonsoir, Monsieur Conari. My pleasure."
Lucien's hand picked at his coat pocket, a nervous habit.
"Welcome to our annual client party," Félix winked. "Impressed with success, you know."
Lucien didn't. but he nodded. Félix put an arm around him and escorted him inside the large apartment's reception rooms, which were high-ceilinged and adorned by carved moldings, parquet flooring, and marble fireplaces. Lucien managed a smile, hoping his eyes didn't reveal his surprise. A mix of flat-chested, hollow-cheeked, mini-skirted models, advertising médiathèques clad in head-to-toe black, and bourgeois matrons clad in Chanel hovered by the table, which was spread with hors d'oeuvres. The hum of conversation and the clink of glasses filled the air. Right behind them, a man entered and handed his overcoat to a waiter.
"The police are blocking back streets. Someone's been murdered on a roof," he announced with irritation. "It's a mess. I couldn't find a parking place."
"Someone murdered?" Lucien concealed his shaking hands by putting them in his pockets. With his background, he had to steer clear of this.
"Nom de Dieu," said Félix, as a momentary hush filled the salon. "At least it seems under control."
Félix guided Lucien toward the long, white linen-covered table.
"Taste the foie gras, and let's catch up in the study."
"Merci,"
Lucien said, conscious of Félix's practiced finesse as he was marshaled, with a well-loaded Limoges plate, to the study. A fire crackled, illuminating minimalist furniture at odds with the ornate ceiling, wood-paneled walls, and curved windows. Old world meets avant-garde. A man came out of the door in an adjoining bathroom, toweling his wet hair.
"Had to splash myself awake,"
he said, smiling.
"You still working?"
Félix pulled Lucien toward the man, who looked to be in his 30s. He wore a rumpled black suit and scuffed Adidas sneakers. His brown hair was pulled back in a ponytail.
"Meet Jan, an associate. He does the brain work. I'm just the brawn,"
Connery joked. Jan grinned.
"Not always."
He shook Lucien's hand.
"A pleasure."
Lucien felt a moist but strong grip. Then Jan shut down a laptop sitting on the desk.
"I promised Félix to mingle and try to improve my social skills. Excuse me."
Lucien practiced his smile again.
"You're so kind to invite me, Monsieur Connery."
"Call me Félix."
Lucien had sent Connery several tapes of his music, but Félix's invitation to come to his home to discuss them had surprised him. Lucien had no rent money in his pockets. A sleeping bag in the pantry of Anna's Corsican communist resto, where he worked for food, was his bedroom now. He prayed this meeting would lead somewhere. Lucien's cousin's great-aunt had married a distant relation of Félix Connery's. Félix wasn't even Corsican, but in Corsica, family meant everything. Clan ties and family connections from the 13th century still governed the island. The code was strong. The basics still operated in Paris.
"Have your drink while you listen to my proposal."
Félix gestured Lucien to a curved blonde wood sculptural chair.
"I'd like you to let me represent you and to introduce your work to the head of Soundworks."
"Soundworks? The European recording giant?" Lucien blinked in surprise.
"You have a unique sound. Haute coule," Félix told him. "I want to help you."
It was an offer Lucien hadn't even dreamed of. He was almost afraid to believe it was real.
"You possess the gift, hard to define. As though you concoct words from the air and the stars sing." "I'm saying it badly."
A brief sadness crossed the face of this man in a designer's suit.
"My sister had it, too. She was so gifted, but she passed away."
He looked down, rearranged some papers on his desk.
"I couldn't help her, but I hope you'll give me the chance to advance your career."
Lucien nodded, excited. "So Félix understood his music and admired it, even if he wasn't Corsican. He explained,
"My grandfather, father, and uncle sang polyphony, the seconda, bass, and terza, 9th-century poems in a cappella. At home, our saying is, 3 singers in harmony make an angel's voice."
His heart raced. It always did when he spoke about his music.
"Music filled our house. I build on the traditional foundation. I use it as a base, and I go on to explore. I want to open our culture to the world."
The door opened, letting in the snare drum of a bossa nova and the murmurs of the crowd. Lucien turned. The woman he'd seen in the doorway entered the room. She'd thrown her head back, laughing. That long neck curved, so familiar. Could it be? She wore a clinging, coppery red dress. Her straight black hair hit the middle of her bare back. She turned, her face caught in the light, and he recognized Marie-Dominique, his first woman. She still wore the scent of roses. He froze. 4 years.
"Ah, Lucien, meet my wife," Félix said. "Forgive me for not introducing you."
Marie-Dominique? Félix's wife? He couldn't pull his eyes away. Marie-Dominique's gaze caught his as she inhaled briefly.
"Lucien," she breathed out, "I'm happy to meet you."
The world stopped. In Lucien's mind, the cicadas were buzzing, their loud cacophony a wall of sound in the dry heat. The leaning pines, sheltered by granite formations, the parched oleander and withered browning myrtle were all around them on the hill where he'd last seen her.
"Hasn't Félix shown you around? You look lost," she said.
Lost in the past, he thought, and pining for a future they'd never had.
"How long have you lived in Paris?"
What he meant was, how long had she been this sophisticated Parisienne married to a wealthy man? She looked down, curling a black strand of her hair around her finger, just as he remembered her doing when she was thinking.
"Long enough," she said.
"Marie-Dominique," Félix said, putting his arm around her, "find Lucien a seat at the table next to us. Persuade him to play something after dinner."
Lucien knew he should thank Félix for his hospitality and leave before he made the biggest mistake of his life. But Marie-Dominique's scent and his memories paralyzed him. Amusement glimmered in Félix's eyes as he said,
"Lucien, you'll let me help you?"
Lucien nodded, tongue-tied.
"As long as you're not involved in Corsican political causes or the separatist groups, are you?"
Félix asked. Should he reveal his past? But how could he tell the truth? He was an unknown. He played in Corsican restaurants to eat. Soundworks would make him.
"Félix, I'm just a musician."
"Good. Monsieur Kouros of Soundworks wants to meet you. He's a personal friend, Lucien," Félix said. "Connections are what count in this world. Forgive me if I assume too much, but I have already given him my word that you'd sign an exclusive contract."
Lucien's mouth felt dry. Should he ask to read the contract, he wondered. Seeing Marie-Dominique while listening to Félix's proposal had his mind reeling. Félix rubbed his chin between his thumb and forefinger.
"You look unsure. After you meet Kouros, you'll understand."
Out in the salon, Lucien's collar felt damp. He'd been perspiring. All about him, couples chatted, and everyone seemed to know one another. His awkwardness increased as he observed the well-dressed strangers surrounding him. A waiter in a white coat stared at him. He had black eyes and an olive complexion that were at odds with his bleached blonde curly hair. A Corse, like himself, Lucien figured, trying to get by. Lucien summoned a smile.
"What village do you come from?" he asked, the question Corsicans always put to a fellow countryman. It was a way to pinpoint their place on the social map, to discover who their friends were, what power they had access to, or even if they were by chance related. Or, worst scenario, if they were involved in a complex vendetta against his clan, one that might have arisen from the defense of the honor of a twice-removed murdered cousin from the last century. These things had to be explored.
Monsieur?
The waiter addressed him as if Lucien hadn't spoken.
Monsieur Canary said to tell you that dinner's served in the other salon.
Then he edged closer and responded,
I'm from Bastia.
An Italian, as the people from his rock-perched village would say. To them, all coastal people were descended from Italian fishermen, even if their ancestors had reached Corsica 5 centuries earlier.
And you?
Vescovatu,
Lucien said. A look of recognition flashed in the waiter's eye. Already, Lucien was one up, hailing from a mountainous inland valley, a more pure Corsican. Felix came up behind him, clapping him on the back, and flashed a big smile.
Listen, we'll sign the contract after dinner. You're going places, young man. I'll see to it.
Loud footsteps pounded across the parquet floor. And then Marie-Dominique's dress rustled, brushing his hand as she turned, searing his fingers with a touch as light as a leaf.
Monsieur Connery,
the waiter said,
the commissaire wants to speak with you.
The commissaire? About what? We're having a party.
Several blue-uniformed policemen entered the crowded room. Had the flics seen him, Lucien wondered. Had someone identified him? The old man with the dog? Nom de Dieu. What if they connected him with the shooting? Or with the Corsican separatists? Foreboding flooded him. It felt like when he'd been little, and the Matsera, the village shaman, had seen the spell cast on him by the evil eye. But no, this was not scientific. He was scientific, and didn't believe in those things any longer.
Monsieur Connery, you're the host,
said a brittle voice. Not waiting for a reply, it continued.
We're sorry for the inconvenience, but a homicide's been committed across the courtyard. We need to speak with all your guests to find out if they noticed anything suspicious. We must check their papers. It's just a formality, of course.
Monday night. Emile twisted Guy's ring back and forth on her middle finger. The cloudy moonstone in an antique setting reflected the sky's changing weather. Perfect for her, he'd said. She tried to think of something else. The commissariat cubicle in which she sat being questioned felt glacial. Several overhead fluorescent panels had burnt out, casting uneven stripes of light on the pitted linoleum. Opposite her, at the metal desk, a 20-something fleek with a razor-sharp jaw pecked with 2 fingers at the keys of a black typewriter. Didn't he have a computer?
Voilà, Mademoiselle Leduc,
he said, pulling the paper out of the roller. His cigarette smoldered in a filled ashtray. He leaned back in his swivel chair and eyed his large sports watch.
Read over your statement to see that it's correct, then sign at the bottom.
She read the 5-page statement twice, then nodded and signed. Please attach this too.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.